These are SG90 servos. They're a relatively cheap and relatively cheaply made servo. For non-critical functions, they're okay. I would not trust one of these in an airplane that was very expensive. And the repeatability from one servo to the next is not that great. There is a wiper inside here. And the signal from the controller or from the receiver or transmitter, if you're flying an airplane, the signal comes in over this orange wire and it tells the servo to go to a certain value on a wiper pot. There's a little wiper resistor in here. And it tells, that signal tells the servo to go to a certain position. When we build this clock, these servos will be in all different positions because the repeatability of the manufacturer is not that great. We have a function inside the sketch that allows us to adjust the position of this servo. So when this is like this, we call that on. And we want to adjust this as parallel to the frame as possible. We're trying to adjust things like the slot. And then when the servo is off, we want this to be at right angles to the frame. So when we look at the clock from this angle, we're just seeing an edge of this. Now, that makes these digits, these numbers, a lot easier to read. There's a function in the sketch that allows us to adjust all of the on positions. We will obtain the numerical value of the servo positions, and we will plug that back into the sketch. And we'll do the same thing for all of these for the off position, and then take those numerical values and plug it back into the sketch. When we connect power to the clock, it goes to eights across the board. Then it goes to the time. The clock is set with these two buttons. If you push both of these buttons at the same time and let go of it, this will display a Y. And then we want to go to the year. In this case, it would be 21. We push the button again. This will go to M. There'll be an M here. We go to the month, push the button again, there'll be a D. We want to put the day of the month for the date. Again, we push it, and then we can adjust hours. We push the button again, and we adjust minutes. And then I wait until the clock on my computer is just approaching 12, and I try to hit the button again as close to as I can that will sync this to the computer time. The real-time clock module that's in here now is quite accurate. If I push one button again and hold it, it will jump back and forth between 12 and 24-hour format. If I want to work on the clock, I plug it in, and when it goes to eights, then I can turn the clock over, and it's easy to work on it, and I won't damage those servos. I want to be a little bit gentle with this. This is the same real-time clock module as what's in my digital LED clocks. And we have a relay that works off of this infrared sensor. And this is what turns the power on and off to these driver boards. So when the clock goes to sleep, these servos are dead. They're not drawing power. The power is turned off to this clock right now, so these servos are free to move. When the clock is operating, when the infrared sensor doesn't detect anyone in the room, and it turns this clock off, when all of these lay down and go to sleep, we want these servos to be power off. We're not powering or wearing out the electronics in the servo for no reason. When the clock goes to sleep, the Arduino and the power supply and the clock are all still powered up, and the circuit board for the servo drivers are still powered up. But we have turned the power off to all 28 servos. The normal state for this relay is normally open, which means that this is not powered. And that's assumed for, like, out here in the shop, I might only be out here for 8 hours a day. The rest of the day, I'm not out here. There's no reason for these servos to be powered up. And so this would be off. If the infrared sensor detects someone in the shop, then it turns the power onto the servos. And that's the only time that this is energized. The real-time clock module has a battery in it. If there's a power failure, when the power comes back on, this will restore the correct time to the clock. In the sketch, there are some lines that pertain to automatic daylight savings time. And there are two lines that are commented out for Europe, and then the two lines for the USA in this program are uncommented. And those contain the dates and the time when the U.S. goes on or off daylight savings time, and those changes will be handled automatically. The delay on the PIR is set for 1 minute, and I'm standing out of range of the sensor. Those lay down pretty fast. And it wakes up pretty fast. The adjustment of those servos, when we have the servo on, I need to adjust these to where they're as parallel to the frame as possible. And then when they're off, to try and adjust these to where they're straight up and down. So when you look at it, you're just getting an edge-on view of this, and the digits are easier to read. Now this thing, I have had it wake up from about 15 foot away. This is not real sensitive from the side. It is from the front. The two clocks are using different PIR sensors. This one is 12 volt, and we're getting 12 volts for this from the wall power supply, and we also are putting 12 volts into this Uno at VN. Everything else is 5 volt, and the relay is turning the voltage on and off at this point. This goes on and off, it turns the servos on and off, but the 5 volt voltage is still going into VCC, so these boards are still awake. And we're just waiting for the relay to put power back here so the servos can wake up. The following diagram is for wiring this clock with the 12 volt PIR. This clock is using the 5 volt PIR. And the wiring for this is a little different. We're still using 12 volts to VN on the Uno, but we only have 5 volts going to the PIR. And the relay is still switching the power on and off to the servo driver boards. And the following diagram is for the wiring of this clock using the 5 volt PIR. Remove two screws and take the back off. You can take this board out of here. And this plastic dome, it has two legs in here, and they have melted those over to hold that in place. You take a screwdriver and you can fleck those bits of plastic off of there, and then you can remove the dome. And this sensor is being held away from the board by this piece of plastic tube. And this is a four-wire sensor. You need a solder sucker to come in here and unsolder these four pins, which can be done. And I have attached these four pieces of telephone wire, and this is about 8.5 inches long. This is an experiment just to see how the sensor would work when I removed it from the board. Also, this sensor has a little pin sticking out here that gives orientation to that. You want to make a mark on your board so when you put these wires on here, this is attached in the right orientation on these four pins. And I've got a base that I've made for the clock. It's got a stem sticking out of here. And this sensor, I may have to grind that pin off of there, but that sensor will go in here like that. And then this will sit on the clock, and I think it'll look a lot nicer. A problem with the 5-volt PIR, depending on what listing you look at, you'll find some that show that this board is centered on this plastic. But in reality, this is a careless assembly, and the board is way off center. And these pins, this is a 3-pin PIR, and they've already been soldered in there and cut off short. I'm going to try to make a version of this base that will go through. Or I may try to unsolder these and put a piece of wire on there. For the dome, the actual base will have a stem on it that goes through a 1/2-inch hole. And then there's a glue ring that goes around that. And you push that on there tight and sandwich this in that piece of 1/4-inch plywood. Put a little glue around that and that'll stay in place. I'm going to drill a 1/2-inch hole so that stem will go down in the hole. And then this dome will sit here just like that. If I can't make a base for the 5-volt one, then I will probably use this one on the other clock where these are white. I'll insert that right into that white one and probably won't even notice it on the white clock. The buttons are only needed for setting the clock and maybe once a year to update the time, if that. And then that will go up and hide behind the frame, out of sight. I rebuilt this clock several times. The first time because I did not like the inaccuracies of the clock module that was initially used. And again, because I didn't like my color choices. My friend in Germany, Daniel Sickert, went through and made a lot of changes to this sketch at my request and put a lot of time and effort into really improving this sketch. If you want your clock to use a better clock module, the DS3231, the relay and the infrared sensor so that this clock has sleep mode for the servos, a much easier process for fine-tuning these servo positions, and automatic daylight savings time correction, then you would want to use Daniel's sketch. And that sketch will be available upon request. Daniel did an extremely good job of modifying this sketch, especially when you consider he did not have one of these clocks in his possession, nor did he have any of these servos to work with. And I certainly appreciate the effort that he put into this sketch.